ready to begin. I apologize, last week I wasn't here. I ended up having to go to America on a sort of emergency visit, but thank God everything is okay. So we are picking up today with our continuation of the study of the Ten Commandments. We're at number 9, which in the counting of the Sefer HaChinuch is the 37th mitzvah, chronologically speaking, from the beginning of Bereishit. We're still, of course, in Parshat Yitro with the Ten Commandments, and the mitzvah is, thou shalt not bear false witness. You'll notice a lot of the things we'll discuss today are parallel to some of the other mitzvot, and we've been developing a theme a little bit in terms of what does it mean to recognize God, right? This is parallel with the mitzvot, well, this is parallel with Shabbat, right? If we go across the line of the Ten Commandments, which is sort of a foundational mitzvah of recognizing God in this world. It also has a lot of similarities with the mitzvah we learned about do not steal, because one of the concepts we spoke about in do not steal was gneva dat, about stealing one's mind, about which is a form of lying, so you'll see that. You'll see other parallels as well. One of the underlying questions we're going to ask is the same question we asked with regards to stealing. If you remember, with regards to stealing, there was a machloket of, is this mitzvah a specific mitzvah? Remember, the Sefer Chinuch says, do not kidnap. It was really stealing a human being. It was stealing a person. And he said that because there's a capital crime involved. All the Ten Commandments involved capital crime, so we needed something like that. Or do we hold like the Midrashim and the Tosfot? He says, no, it's a more general prohibition of not stealing anything. And that's how we could get to something like Gneivat Dat, which was one of the seven different forms of theft. Here we'll have the same question. Do not bear false witness. Are we talking about a specific case in courts of a witness going up and testifying falsely of lying? Or are we talking about the general mitzvah of not lying, of being truthful in all of our deeds, all of our actions, how we hold ourselves out? And as we saw with theft, there's two sides. Both have, I think, something to learn from and strong positions. We'll start with the Sefer HaChinuch. And the Sefer HaChinuch is, I would argue, very much in support of the first position, that this mitzvah, the Ten Commandments, we're talking about court case, we're talking about a witness who's called up, and this is specifically for that individual. There's obvious problems with saying the Ten Commandments, this mitzvah in the Ten Commandments, only applies to court cases. What might be one of the problems right away? Well, how many times have you been called to a witness, to be a witness in a case? So it doesn't necessarily apply to the vast majority of Jews. And we'll see that a little bit later as well. But let's look first at the Sefer HaChinuch and see how he understands it, and specifically the court case. And then we'll look at the other possibilities as well. Okay, so the Sefer HaChinuch is the first source. You'll see he says, Shelo la'id b'sheker, you shall not testify or give testimony. You shall not be a witness for falsehood. Shelo la'id edut sheker, that you are not to give testimony or give false testimony. It's interesting. He doesn't say don't be an aid sheker, a false witness, but don't give false testimony. This might be one sort of hint where the Sefer HaChinuch holds that it's about being in a court case. Because if you said don't be a false witness, you could be a false witness outside of the courtroom. But false testimony seems much more clearly connected to case. And you see that he changes the language of the Torah. The Torah says, lo ta'ane berecha ad echeker. Don't oppress your neighbor, your friend, as a false witness. And he says it's also written in another location as well. In fact, it's written in a number of different places about not being a false witness. And always the Sefer HaChinuch says it's regarding court cases. Even there's an additional mitzvah, additional verse in the Torah that says, midvar sheker tirchak, from false matters stay away from, meaning not only are you not allowed to lie explicitly, but you should also not even let someone believe something you're saying in the wrong way. From all false matters, he says that's also in a court case. That's also related to court cases and things along those lines. He doesn't count it as the same mitzvah. He counts it a few different times. But he says each one has a slight variation. Sometimes we're talking about don't lie in a financial case, don't lie in a capital case, but
counts each one separately,
but they're all connected to this concept of not giving false testimony in a courtroom, which we'll see in distinction to the other opinions out there. What's the problem? Why is this such a serious offense not to give false testimony in a courtroom? What's the big problem with that? You see the second paragraph in Hebrew, Shorash mitzvah zo nigla. This root of this commandment is revealed, meaning it's actually obvious. You understand why it would be a problem. As falsehood is disgraceful and vile on its own right, you don't need to even give a reason. We understand, everyone understands why falsehood is a problem. No one enjoys being lied to. People understand that it's a big problem in society when there's lying, when you can't trust what anyone else is saying. There's something very disgraceful of that. It's in the eyes of any intelligent one understands why this is a problem. Also because the world stands upon true testimony. I would say this is a dual potential meaning. One is, this is the same language, right? Ha'olam omed, the world stands. We're talking something almost theologically speaking. The world stands on true testimony. In other words, what are the Jewish people? We are, to a certain extent, representatives of God. And God's signature is truth. And we're, in a sense, playing the role of God in this world and representing God. And if we were to lie and falsehood, we're also, in a sense, denying God. We're also, in a sense, disgracing God. It's a chilul Hashem. If human beings are created b'tzelem Elokim, in the image of God, and then lie in that regard. And he's also talking about a technical matter as well. Courts in which truth is irrelevant, where people can just lie whatever they want, the courts are going to collapse. People will not have any faith in justice. If you don't have faith in justice, Pirkei Avot says, pray for the government, because if you don't have order, if you don't have structure, we would have what Hobbes would say, right? You know, a world of chaos, where life is short, brutish, right? It's terrible in the law of nature. And therefore, courts give us a certain structure, an order in our lives. Listen, if you can't rely on the courts, you can't rely on justice. So people will then do whatever they want. They're not going to obey the law because they're not going to get a fair shake. People will be speeding. People will be stealing. In a sense, the courts are a safeguard against all the commandments, right? You have to know that there's a certain amount, that there's a din and a dayan, there's a law and there's a judge, and people will be held accountable. Otherwise, people will simply try to get away with whatever they can get away with. You actually see a little bit of this. By the way, it's also terrible for the person who lies, right? The person who lies is also defeated, because very often if they live in a world where everyone is lying, they're also recipients of this negative society. And you see it in the famous case in Malachim, they made a play about it actually, not too long ago at the Chan Theater, about the story of Isabella, the evil queen married to Ahab, the king. They lived in Jezreel, right, the Jezreel Valley, and the king is looking out one day and he sees the beautiful vineyards of Navot, and he says, I want you to sell me the vineyards. And Navot says, no, I can't sell it to you. Right? We spoke a little bit about Yovel, and the land has to return to the original owners. The king is not impressed with this piety, and the queen says, you're the king, you deserve whatever you want. Right? By the way, that, of course, is not the Jewish understanding of the king. In the rest of the Middle East in those days, the king was viewed as God. Right? And that's why you didn't look at any of the flaws of the ancient kings, because they were God. That was revealing something that shouldn't be revealed. They had absolute total power. In Jewish thought, the king is God, right? God is the king, right? Right? The king is God in other societies, but God is king. We have no king whatsoever. And indeed, when the people beg for a king, right? Shmuel is hesitant. God is hesitant. Finally says, fine, if you want a king, fine, right? Why did they want a king? It's not that they wanted a king in the sense of, we don't want a different God, but we have enemies from around. A king is able to organize an army, is able to collect taxes, we'll be able to better defend ourselves if we're united under one king, as opposed to, you know, a confederate of 12 different disparate type of tribes. So they begged for a king, they needed a king, and God understood that. But he also understood that there's problems in bringing in the king. Nevertheless, King Ahab says, I want what I want. The queen hires false witnesses, Adam Zomamim, right? False witnesses, there's a slight distinction we should know. Adam Zomamim are plotting witnesses. False witnesses are people who give false testimony but are not necessarily Adam Zomamim. What's the difference? An Eid Zomim, a plotting witness, is someone who was not even at the event, who was, the way the Gemara describes it, a witness says that this person killed so-and-so. Another witness comes along and says, this witness who just testified wasn't even in the city when it took place. He was with me in Hawaii, you know, and are totally at the exact same time. There's no way he could even give testimony at all. That's an Eid Zomim. And what do we do with that individual? We do exactly what he intended to do to others, we do to him. So if he, in giving that false testimony, was trying to get this person to be killed or take money from him or whatever the case may be, we actually then punish that person with death. That's different than a false witness who, let's say, who gives testimony but is just inaccurate. He was there. It was possible that he could have given, but he's maybe lying or misunderstood or the other case. And we understand why there might be a distinction. False testimony is actually quite common. Eyewitness testimony that is inaccurate is very common that it's inaccurate. And you can't always figure out whether or not the person had bad intention or not. So that person is not punished. Their testimony is simply removed. But the testimony of a Eid Zomim is actually used for them to be punished in with whatever they wanted to do. I hope this is not a bomb that's about to go off. Excuse me? Okay, hopefully it will. Okay. There it goes. Good, it's off. But the reason I brought this case, what did the queen do? She hires witnesses. The witnesses lie. They say that Navot, who was a very pious individual, in fact, had cursed God, had cursed the king, and is put to death based upon her bringing these false witnesses. People knew this was not true, but they followed the law exactly as it was to be followed. They had witnesses. There were no false witnesses that came. There were no witnesses that came to deny that they were there. And therefore, Navot was put to death, and the land was given to them. That system has no faith whatsoever, right? No one has faith, therefore, in the justice system that is used to pervert and used to oppress honest individuals. And so therefore the entire system falls apart, and indeed their kingship does fall apart based upon this type of corrupt behavior, technically under the guise of law. This, by the way, also shows you the problem with lying, because even the king and the queen call the false witnesses that did their will, right? They paid them, we want you to testify falsely, they did exactly what they're told. The king and the queen call them scoundrels, because anyone who is willing to testify falsely is obviously a terrible person, even though we paid you and you did exactly what we wanted to do. So the liar himself is also punished. This introduction of, by the way, the concept of Eid Zomamim, well, let's hold it for 1 second. I want to say one more thing before we get to that. Still inside the Sefer Chinuch, how do I know really that Sefer Chinuch is talking only about court cases? Read the next. Zomim Zion Mem Mem, or Zion Vav Mem Mem. The last paragraph I'll read in the English, and it is practiced, this law, in every place and at all times by males, but not by females. Here's another problem with saying it's only related to courts. Once you say it's only related to courts, so then you say, well, it can only apply to witnesses. And in Jewish law, there are a number of people who are either exempt from, or we just left that closed because there's a lot of noise from the outside. Yesh rash b'chutz, as sagarnu et ha'delet. So what does that do? This is one of the problems with the Sefer Chinuch's position. It means anyone who can't be a witness in a court case, therefore this mitzvah doesn't apply to them. Seems very odd to say that one of the Ten Commandments doesn't apply to half the population, doesn't apply to women. By the way, we should also think about this for a moment as well. What does it mean when it says that women are prohibited from being witnesses? The list of people who are prohibited in Jewish law is actually very, very wide, much, much wider and broader than in secular courts, for example. The litigant is not allowed to be a witness. In secular courts, if you bring a claim against someone, you're allowed to be a witness. Litigant can't be a witness. We assume that he only has his self-interest, right? The American system is very much a confrontational system. We assume that everyone maybe is lying, and we, in a sense, try to get the truth by challenging them and asking questions and the like. But we're in the Jewish system, we're trying to understand truth. So we know already that what's concerned for us is if this individual has a vested interest, we can't include him. So litigants are not allowed. Anyone who is, by the way, not a litigant is one, the person who's in one of the claimants, right? I'm suing you, I'm a litigant in the case. You have to be Shomer Shabbat, Shomer Kashrut. Why? Why does that make a difference? It's not so much that we believe the Shomer Kashrut or Shomer Shabbat person more so than another individual, but it may be in the court that we're going to ask you to give an oath. And the oath has to be incredibly serious, and we have to believe 100% that you're going to tell the truth in this oath, and the weight of the oath is that you're taking God's name and using God's name. And so therefore, if you don't keep Shabbat or don't keep kosher, we don't think you necessarily are concerned about saying God's name in vain either. So it's a test. Certainly you can't be, a whole series of criminals are not allowed. You can't have any vested interest, meaning even if you're not a litigant, but if you have a financial interest, no relatives are allowed, right? All of these are allowed in regular courts. In Israeli law, not so. And then, of course, as I said, women are not allowed. And there's a machloket why women are not allowed to be witnesses in Jewish law. It's an interesting question. In Israeli law, in 1951, a law was passed that says explicitly men and women equally are allowed to be witnesses. There, I think, the reason why it was put forth so early on is because already in 1948, you had both chief rabbis, Rav Uziel and Rav Herzog, both offer in some way an argument that women can and perhaps should be witnesses in Jewish courts. Their arguments are slightly different, and it goes back to a machloket with the Rambam. The Rambam says, why is it that women are not allowed to be witnesses? It has nothing to do with women per se. It's simply a way we learn the text. The text says edim, which is witnesses in the male form. It doesn't say witnesses in a female form. So it's simply male because that's what the Torah says. The Shulchan Aruch asks a very obvious question on the Rambam. He says, wait a second. All the language of the Torah is in the male form, right? We know today, even grammatically speaking, if you have a room full of 100 women and there's 5 men, you address and the male form. Although there's a machloket about that now today. And my daughters came home from school. They said, now you go by the majority. But I asked Hebrew teachers and they say, no, we still do the male form. Sometimes we do both. So the Rambam says it's only because it's a Gezeirah Shavos in the verse itself. Others, however, say no. It's because women, and there's two ways of understanding this. There's women are not qualified in the matters that take place in courts. If there's a financial matter, women, certainly in the times of the Rambam, would not have had the need or therefore any experience or skill in dealing with financial matters. They would have been primarily in home. They're not in commercial transactions. And therefore, they're not able to give testimony because they wouldn't necessarily understand those things. So Rav Uziel, well, Rav Herzog says flat out, today that's no longer an issue. In 1948, women have exposure, meaning he holds, not like the Rambam, that it's a permanent, eternal law that women cannot be testified because it says edim, male, but he says it's based upon women's experience. He says today, women do have this commercial experience. They are outside the house. They are exposed to these things, so therefore they can give testimony. Rav Uziel says the Sephardic tradition is a little bit more sort of traditional, so to speak, and he says, no, women still don't have the experience in financial matters, but in any area where they do have experience, they can give testimony. And of course, Rav Uziel is suggesting also, if we got to a time where women did have experience also in financial matters, then there too they should be allowed to be witnesses. So therefore, when the law was passed in 1951 that said women can be witnesses, they actually had the support of both chief rabbis at the time. Yes. Right, so that's that. Interesting enough, the Rambam doesn't use that language, although he uses it elsewhere. So yeah, that's the second way of understanding the other opinion. The other opinion is that women can't give testimony because they're not, they don't have knowledge. So one way of understanding is because they don't have experience. And the second way of understanding is that they don't have the intelligence in general. So some people have said that as well, and therefore they also wouldn't change. They would still say that women cannot be witnesses. But it's interesting that Rav Herzog and Rav Uziel focused on the concept of experience or exposure. In other words, once a woman does have exposure and experience, then there shouldn't be a problem. The third reason why women are often excluded as witnesses is because of a different philosophical principle that says, you know, the glory, the kavod bat melech, the glory of a woman is internal, inside the house. And so therefore, things, even if a woman has total knowledge and experience, she shouldn't necessarily come out. Someone wrote an interesting article, Rabbi Saul Berman wrote an article years ago, and he said that this position actually has economic values and concerns in mind. He notes, for example, many people would say, listen, the king also, right? It's below the king's honor to have to leave the palace in order to go to the marketplace where these court cases took place, and it was dirty, and you know they were shouting and screaming. You know, it's beneath his honor, and so many people would say the same thing about a woman. It's beneath her honor to have to go out where there's this sort of, you know, wild marketplace. Rabbi Berman says something different. Rabbi Berman says, in every society that permits or encourages women to leave the house, it almost always becomes obligatory to leave the house. In other words, you see it a little bit in American society today, that a woman who stays in the house, who decides my job is going to be as a homemaker, I'm going to raise the children, I'm going to spend full time more or less at home, begins to almost feel discriminated against, as if she's not fulfilling her role. He says this happens in many societies, that if a person is permitted to do something and they choose not to, there's incredible amount of social pressures and also economic pressures, right? Because now in a sense you're leaving money on the table. Both adults could be working, and now only one adult is working. There's all this money that the family could have and they're not having because she's decided to stay home. Isn't that selfish? All these other things. And he says, therefore, there's always this tremendous economic pressure for women to go out of the house, even if that's not their preference. He always said that Judaism is not about insisting a woman stay at home, but giving her the right, if she wanted to, in order to raise her children and do that. And so he says a lot of the laws, for example, that have to do with Shazman Grama, right, time-bound mitzvot, is the same concept, is to basically rebalance the situation so that if women wanted to stay home, they would feel permitted and encouraged to do that as well, just as much as the other, as a value, exactly. And so therefore he says, a woman therefore is not permitted to go out, because the second she's permitted to go out for the going to a court case or having to go to minyan or having to go to any of these other things, the permission becomes obligatory, and then all of a sudden she no longer has the right to say, no, this is my primary incentive. So that's his article. Those are three of the positions about women and giving testimony. The middle position, as I said, seems to be where a lot of rabbis have taken it. So even those, for example, who still say women shouldn't give testimony, there are a number of cases where, well, we accept a woman's testimony in this instance. We accept a woman's, meaning only in the classic case of two witnesses giving testimony about, you know, let's say a murder or something like that, we exempt the woman. But in almost all these other cases, it's been chipped away significantly in modern Jewish law. No, it's the Israeli, right. So many rabbinical courts still do not accept, except in the what I had just mentioned, is sort of chipping away and finding and sort of expanding out. Even the Minchas Chinuch on the Sefer Chinuch says, we also, there are many instances that we begin to accept a woman if we know, for example, that her testimony is correct and that two witnesses could never have perhaps given the testimony, or she's the only thing that we have to rely upon.
Be the witness for the witness.
Exactly. We find ways to therefore bring the woman in this case. Yes. Already it began, exactly. One that a woman is one, a single woman, and all these, not a single woman, one woman. Yeah, exactly. Okay. Okay. The reason why I mentioned, by the way, Adam Zomimim, and those cases in general, is because the Sefer Chinuch, one of the arguments he's making is that we're focusing on the testimony. We don't actually care about the truth. We don't care about the persons involved. We care about the edut. That's what's important. But you can still hold the exact same position that it's only dealing with court cases and say we're focusing on the aid, the witness, and the perfect case, of course, is that is the aid zomim, the conspiring or plotting witness. Here, we're not concerned necessarily with truth. We're concerned with procedure, right? We don't know if the person A murdered B or not. But if the witness, C, couldn't possibly give the testimony because they were out of the country, that's what our concern is. And so therefore, we disqualify that person. And we don't, even if it's true, by the way, the interesting rabbinical case, if you were talking about the rabbinical courts, are you allowed to have a polygraph in Jewish law in a rabbinical court? Is it accepted? By the way, secular court has the same issue. What? A lie detector. So Israeli law, by the way, says you are allowed to use lie detectors in the investigation of the process to sort of help you figure things out, but not in the courtroom itself. The courtroom itself, it counts as a form of testimony, but not by its, it doesn't stand by itself. It's not as if you have two witnesses that are giving testimony. It doesn't have that weight. It has the weight not even of one witness, eyewitness, which is still more significant, but it has the weight of sort of circumstantial evidence. And the case actually was decided in the Supreme Rabbinical Court by Rav Eliezer Waldenberg. And he says, he quotes a midrash of Kohelet, who was trying to make a decision, and he made a decision because he had prophecy in his heart. And then a bat kol comes down and says, don't judge according to your wisdom, don't judge according to your prophecy, but only judge according to two witnesses. So Rav Eliezer Waldenberg says, this is a proof that you can't use a lie detector as the basis. The case itself took place in Haifa, that there was a married woman who was secluded with her boss, who was not her husband, in Haifa, and the husband sued for divorce. He says, you know, this is not permitted. There's yichud and everything like that. But in Jewish law, that in itself is not sufficient grounds for divorce. It raises a lot of questions, so he wanted to use a lie detector on the wife, whether or not she had an adulterous relationship. And Rav Eliezer Waldenberg says, we do not allow, in this instance, the lie detector. It's not the same as a witness. We don't regard it in the same way. Okay. So those are some of the issues about aid zomim and giving false testimony and the dangers involved in that regard. I just want to see if there's anything else I want to say on that matter. We can come back to that. Adam Zomim is a very interesting case. The most difficult question of Adam Zomim is, why do we treat the Adam Zomim is punished for what he tries to do. If he gives false testimony against a person, let's say against this person, that this person killed B, he is put to death. But only before the final decision. If the court has already ruled and put A to death, meaning the Eid Zomim is successful, then the Eid Zomim is not put to death. Because the text says, Kasher hu zamam, as he intended to do, but not as he actually did. So everyone always asks the question, wait a second, isn't it a Kal Vachomer? If he's put to death for what he intended to do, how come he, for all the more so, he should be put to death for when he actually is successful? Excuse me. And anyway, that's one of the questions that stands. There are different answers that are given. Most of them focus on the text base itself. There was an Israeli court case. Eid Zomamim does not exist in Israeli law, okay? If a it almost existed. There was a case where bankers had lied to individuals, and the person made certain financial decisions based upon the lying of the bank, and the bankers were put in jail. So the person who then paid for the fine, you know, lost their money, sued the bank and said, not only should they be put in jail, these bankers in their false testimony were trying to take money away from me, so I want to now sue and get money returned. And the Supreme Court had the opportunity to say, we will abide by the laws of Eid Zomim in the Israeli court system. They considered it and they rejected it. And the reason why they rejected it is actually, they said, first of all, in the Torah, it wasn't between individuals, meaning this individual wanted to get the money from the bank. In the Torah, the money would go to the court, meaning the person is punished, but it's not for the benefit of the witness that or the individual they were accusing. But they also said, maybe people then won't give testimony if they're always being challenged, if they're always being questioned, and so Israeli law does not follow Eidim Zomim like the Torah. Okay. Let's now go to the other side. The other side is that this mitzvah is not specifically about a court case, and we can understand the problems with it. You're saying that it only applies in a court case means only to people who are going to be witnesses, and only people who can be witnesses, which excludes a lot of Jews, and also the more broader concept of lying, right? And we understand that there's something very deeply embedded in Jewish thought of the importance of telling the truth. And so that's the other way of looking at it. There's a number of different sources that talk about, in the Torah, about the importance of not lying. I mentioned already Tehillim that says the seal of God is truth. Liars cannot receive the divine presence. That's from the Babylonian Talmud. There's a whole series. Another example is in Shabbat, the Gemara lists six things that people are asked when they go to Olam Haba. The first question is, did you negotiate, did you engage in your business dealings in honesty? Right? Honesty is a key line here. And all this brings to the sort of a bigger philosophical discussion of whether or not lying, you know that lying is bad, but is lying always bad? Lying should be prohibited across the board. We should be concerned, by the way, if we say yes or no. There was a study done recently that argues that people, on average, lie about 150 times a day, that it's fairly common. So therefore, it's something that needs to be, right? You're saying, okay, how could that be, right? It needs to be something that needs to be uprooted. People are very loose with the truth. But it also reveals something that maybe there's something important about lies. Think about lies for just a moment. The lies, for example, I remember my mother used to always say when my sister just couldn't go to school one day and you had to call the principal or the office to say why your child was not coming to school. My mom felt uncomfortable lying, but sometimes my sister just couldn't, you know, go to school. She just had it. So she'd always say, my daughter today is sick. And then off the phone, she'd say, and tired. Because my mother didn't want to lie, but she also, you know, didn't, you know, but think about all the times a person does lie. Oh, it's great to see you. You look wonderful. Have you lost weight? You look younger. You know, all these little things that we say. Right, what? Not to hurt somebody, right? So imagine if we said the opposite. You know, you look terrible. You look much older than last time I saw you. These are not things that you would necessarily, you know, say. You know, a person gives a speech, you know, that was the best I ever heard. That was wonderful. At a bar mitzvah, the bar mitzvah boy, you know, gives a talk, or Elaine is the best I ever heard. You know, we are sometimes loose with the truth, but as you said, for maybe positive reasons. So it's an interesting philosophical discussion. Actually, Aristotle and Plato started us off. They had this whole, you know, whole one says that under no circumstances can you ever lie. St. Augustine follows along this path. He says it's a matter of principle. If you're representing God, there cannot be any falsehood whatsoever. Kant says the same thing. If if you lie, right? He goes to the point, even if there's a murderer who's chasing an individual and the person hides in your house, and the murderer comes and says, where is that person? You have to point them out, because you can't lie. His whole philosophy is anything, the way you determine a moral act is you universalize it. And therefore, if everyone lied, the world could not exist, right? That's what the Sefer HaChinuch says. And so therefore, there can be no lying whatsoever, even though there's a great cost in never lying. So where does Judaism fall in this? You know, on one hand, we do have all these verses, Midvar Sheker Tirchak, not even get close to a false matter. We have Genevas Dat. We have all these principles. On the other hand, as you correctly points out, there is a concern about people's feelings, right? And so what I did in the source sheet, there's at least four different major categories where Judaism permits lying, at least as we can see in the Babylonian Talmud. We can look at a few of those. Number two, right? Source number two for the Gemara in Yevamot. Rabbi Elazar, the son of Rabbi Shimon, it is permitted for a person to deviate from the truth in the interest of peace. Darche Shalom. We spoke about Darche Shalom a few weeks back about our relationship with non-Jews. The truth is the concept of Darche Shalom is even more significant with the relationship to fellow Jews. What's the case? In Breishit, your father Jacob commanded before his death, this is Yehuda speaking to Yosef. So shall you say to Yosef, oh, please forgive the offense of your brothers and their sins, for they have treated you so wickedly. Right? Yaakov has died. The brothers are fearful that Yosef will now take revenge once Yaakov is now out of the picture. So Yehuda says, I had a conversation with Dad, and Abba said, make sure you don't take revenge on your brothers. We have no record of that actual conversation. Yehuda seems to, I mean, it's possible that it existed, but Yehuda seems to sort of make it up to create peace. Let's remove, you know, Abba said, don't kill us, don't take revenge. And it seems positively in this regard that he might have created this. Rabbi Natan said, you're allowed to also deviate from truth for Darche Shalom in the interest of peace. As Shmuel says, how can I go? If Shaul hears of it, he will kill me, right? Shmuel is going up, and eventually he's going to anoint David HaMelech. He also happens to bring up a karban. And he tells Shaul, I'm bringing up a karban, meaning he tells the truth, because that's, in fact, what he was doing. But he was also doing anointing David as the king. If he told Shaul that he's bringing David as the king, obviously, the Shaul would get furious with him and maybe kill him. And there's other instances of this as well, where Abraham lies, right, going down to Egypt to protect Sarah. There's a midrash of one time he goes down the midrash says he puts Sarah in a box to protect her. And he stopped at the border, and they say, what's inside? And he says, well, I have wheat. And they're like, okay, then we're going to charge you the tax on wheat. He says, okay, I'll pay it. And he was so easy to pay the tax. They said, well, what about, it must be something else. So he says, it's pepper. And he pays the tax on pepper. It's something else. It's gold. He pays the tax on gold. Eventually, they open up the box, and it's Sarah inside. But we learn from that midrash, says the midrash, that you're allowed to lie to save a life. That was his intention in all these instances. At the Academy of Rabbi Yishmael, that's a third example. These are all in the same category, right? Great is the cause of peace, seeing that for its sake, even the Holy One, blessed be, changed the truth, for as it is written, this is the famous case, right? God, Sarah challenges God and says, how can I possibly have a son? Abraham is so old. And when God relays the story to Abraham, right, it says that Sarah is so old. And I am old, right? So to protect people's feelings, you're allowed to change the truth. That's one example. The second example on the next page. The first case when you're allowed to lie is for Darche Shalom. The second case, how does one dance before the bride? This is a famous instance. What does one say in the praise of her? There's actually an argument. The school of Shammai says we praise the bride as she is. If she is beautiful, you say, you look beautiful. If she is ugly, you say she is, well, you try not to, you don't have to say you are ugly, but you can say, aren't those nice shoes? Or you say something else, but you don't lie. You don't lie. The School of Hillel says, we say that she is beautiful and graceful, no matter what. She's beautiful and graceful. And some people interpret this to mean that every bride is beautiful and graceful on her wedding day. And so Hillel is not arguing that you lie, but he's simply arguing that's the truth. But of course, to a certain extent, he may be arguing that you can lie in this regard. School of Shammai says to the School of Hillel, if she was lame or blind, does one say about her that she is beautiful and a graceful bride? But the Torah said, distance yourself from a false matter. Midvar sheker tirchak. School of Hillel said to the School of Shammai, according to your opinion, if someone made an inferior purchase in the marketplace, should one praise it or deprecate it in his eyes? Surely one should praise it. And Beit Hillel knows what they're doing, because Beit Shammai is already on record as saying that when someone buys something in the marketplace, you do not tell them, oh, you got a terrible deal. Right? That's one of the worst things you could do. Like, right, people are always asking, in Israel especially, how much did you pay for this? And you know what's coming next. Oh, you overpaid, right? That, Beit Shammai says, you're not allowed to do, because it hurts a person. They just spent money on something, and it actually hurts a person. So Beit Hillel says, you hold this way with regards to the marketplace, it should also be the same with regards to the bride. Surely one should praise it. From here, the latter statement of the Beit Hillel, a person's disposition should always be pleasant with people, but you should always be pleasant and be positive, and you're allowed to compliment, right? You have to be wary. You're not complimenting for your benefit. One of the ways you determine whether or not a white lie is permissible or not is for whose benefit is it told. Are you doing it for the benefit of the bride, right? You look beautiful. Or are you doing it for your own benefit, right? If you're doing it because you're trying to get out of paying something, or right, you give a person these very flowing compliments and everything like this because you want them to give you a present or to give you a job, that's for your benefit. That you're not permitted to do. But if you're doing it to protect their feelings, that you are permitted to do. Beit Hillel has another source, by the way, for this position. The verse when it says, Midvar sheker tirchak, from a false matter, stay far away, the end of that verse says, because I will slay those who don't bring life. In other words, if what you're doing is bringing life, that is permitted in that regard. So the case of the husband and wife, you're allowing the husband and wife to live together and be happy. You praise the bride in front of the groom. So they're going to create a family and all these wonderful things. Then it becomes permissible. But if what you were doing was going to cause damage, so then you would not be permitted to do so. Another instance, the Babylonian Talmud. Rabbi Yehuda stated in the name of Shmuel, in the following three matters, it is the practice of the rabbis not to tell the truth. Right? The rabbis specifically did not, in the matters of tractate, in the matters of a bed, and in matters of hospitality. In the matters of tractate, if you know a great deal of Gemara, and someone says, oh, do you know all of Shas? The rabbi is allowed to lie and say, no, I only know this one tractate. I don't know that much. Right? As a matter of humility, if you admitted to saying, I in fact know all these things, perhaps it's a sign of arrogance. The concept of bed, there's a machloket. Is it, we're talking about sort of modesty in terms of like sexual issues. The Gemara says, if someone asks the rabbi, did you have relations with your wife yesterday? He can lie as a matter of modesty. Others attack that position and say, what student asked their rabbi, did they have relations with their wife yesterday? It must mean something else with regards to bed, and then give different possibilities. The third, hospitality. If you're allowed to lie, let's say you ate at a person's house, and someone says, how was it? Was the food amazing? Tell me everything. And if, in fact, it was spectacular, and the person went out of their way to help you out and give you the most delicious foods and everything along those lines, you don't have to say that, because if you say all those things, many people now may beat down the door to get into that host's house, and therefore it creates a burden on the host. So you are allowed to say, it was fine, it was nice, it was pleasant, but you don't have to, you know, tell all the details in that regard. The last case you see, one is permitted to make a vow to murderers, plunderers, and corrupt tax collectors, that the produce they wish to seize is truma. Right? If you say something is truma, and therefore it doesn't have the same value because it's going to have to go to the Kohanim and the Levim, which is only permitted to be eaten by the priests and therefore of little value, you're allowed to say those things because these people are simply going to take money from you. In other words, you're not allowed to lie to the tax collectors. By the way, these tax collectors were considered corrupt. They're not the regular tax collectors of organized society. Then in the Middle Ages in particular, but in Babylon as well, tax collectors was a job that you would buy the right to collect taxes from people, particularly Jews, from the king. So you would pay a licensing fee, let's say, you know, $100 to the king. The king has no idea how much money could be collected. So the king gets his $100, and then this tax collector could say his whatever he wanted to collect. He could create exorbitant amounts of money. And so therefore, if he was a corrupt, he should really collect $110, right? Enough for the king, and then $10 for himself. But if he started collecting thousands and thousands of dollars, it was viewed as corrupt and inappropriate, and therefore you were allowed to lie because he was expropriating your property unfairly and unjustly. No, well, that's what I'm saying. If you're living in a society today where it's fair, like it's passed by laws and it's applied equally to everyone, so then no, you don't have the right. But you do have the right, for example, and there are cases of this, where if you are being cheated by someone, you are permitted to, in fact, lie to protect your property. But you're not allowed to lie just to save money. Meaning, in business dealings, you're not allowed to lie to get a better deal or anything like that. What you're allowed to lie is if someone's coming to steal your money, right? Then you are allowed to lie in that regard. In general, you're allowed to use lying as a method of uprooting evil, right? If you're allowed to actually uproot evil, let's say if someone's trying to kill you, you're allowed to defend yourself to the point that you would even kill them. So it makes sense, therefore, you would be allowed to lie to that person if they're coming to try to kill you or if they're coming to try to harm you. So it seems to be permissible. You see at the very bottom, I sort of summarize what I think these Gemaras point out with a number of different examples. Lying to preserve the cause of peace, not to hurt another person's feelings. Lying in a situation where honesty might cause oneself or another person harm. Lying for the sake of modesty. Lying for the sake of decency. Lying to protect one's property from scoundrels. These are just a few of the instances. There are, of course, many instances in the Torah that support these principles. If you think for just a moment, we actually have a great number of cases of lying in the Torah, which I think we view positively. Shifra and Puah is a perfect example. It's interesting to note that some of the early Christian writers, like I think St. Augustine, attack Shifra and Puah for lying. Remember, they save the babies, and they lie, and they say, these Jewish women, they just give birth too quickly. It's a lie to Paro. Some said they shouldn't have done that. They should have stood up and said, this is the case. But what would have happened? They probably would have been killed, and the babies would have been killed. Shifra and Puah in Jewish thought are viewed positively for lying, that it was an act of holiness to lie in this case. I'll give you a couple more cases from the Gemara and as well as from the Torah. There's a famous case in the Talmud about if we're talking about classes, whether or not a person gives a class, if you don't have to exaggerate. Rabbi Meir used to give a lecture, and there was one woman who came to the lecture all the time, and she was late getting home to her husband because the lecture ran over. And the husband was very offended, and the husband says, I will not permit you back in this house until you spit in the eye of Rabbi Meir, right? It's a famous case. Rabbi Meir tells the woman, I'm going to pretend to have something in my eye, and I want you to spit seven times to get it out. And then you can tell your husband you actually outdid yourself. You did it seven times, you spit, even though she thought she was doing it for the benefit of Rabbi Meir. There's a case in in Erevin where Rabbi Yehoshua once stayed at a certain inn. The innkeeper prepared beans the first day, he ate it. The second day, he ate it. The third day, they were burned. And so he chose not to eat it. And so she said, why didn't you eat it today? And he didn't want to offend her, saying that it was not good. So he said he actually ate food previously and was full. There's actually an interesting case that happened here in Israel not too long ago. It was asked of Rabbi Zilberstein. Yitzhak Zilberstein is a rabbi I've quoted before in Bnei Brak. The question he got was from a husband who, you know, worked full days. He was always hungry when he would come home. He'd get home, let's say, 6 o'clock, and as soon as he got home, he was always looking forward to there being a meal ready for him. And he'd get home at 6 o'clock, and his wife hadn't prepared the meal for whatever reason, and she would start talking to him, and she actually liked preparing the meal while he was there, so she could talk and sort of socialize during, but that meant the meal was not ready until 7 or 7:30, and he was always very hungry. So he didn't know what to do. So one of his friends, he didn't want to like complain, he didn't want to cause a fight, so one of his friends gave him a piece of advice: why not eat like a snack on your way home from work? You know, get a sandwich or something like that, so when you get home, you're not starving. So he started doing this all the time. And he would always get like a meat sandwich on his way home, so he wouldn't be full. And his wife always prepared him, you know, meat dishes at dinner. Anyway, one night, of course, what does she end up doing? She feels bad that she hadn't prepared meals all these times. So he comes home, the table is set, the meal is on the table, and what's the meal? A chalavi meal. And he just had a piece of meat. So he wrote Rabbi Yitzchak Zilberstein, and he said, what is the halacha? Am I allowed? Normally I hold 6 hours. Am I allowed to hold, you know, a half hour or something like that? Is it permissible, perhaps, for Darkei Shalom, for the good relations between a man and a woman, that I'm allowed to mix? It's not mixing meat and milk, right? It's more of the rabbinic. And maybe it was even chicken, so it's not like a deraita. You know, am I allowed to for the sake of peace, have the dairy meal? So Rabbi Zilberstein says, no, you're not allowed. You can't, you know, just because you're having snacks and you're going home, you should tell your wife the truth and everything like that. And he says, and if you feel that telling the truth would have caused like a real fight, here's the lie that you should have told. And Rabbi Yitzchak Zilberstein gives him the lie. He says, you should have told him that you were invited to a bris on the way home and therefore you're full and you can't eat, because she can't hold, be upset with you for going to a bris before coming home to eat the meal, because it's a mitzvah to go to the bris, and a bris very often is meat, and so therefore you would be able to get out of it. And so Rabbi Zilberstein points out that lying is preferable to eating meat and milk, or, you know, milk, the rabbinic prohibitions, and in that case it would be permissible in this instance. So it's a similar case of the inn. There's a famous case also with Reb Chia about Rebbe was once delivering a lecture, and all of a sudden he smelled a very bad smell. One of the students had a very strong garlic breath. And I never thought garlic was so strong, but I just returned from America, and I was sitting next to someone, and she told me a story that her father was on the deathbed, and he was like almost in a comatose state. The doctors had given very short time to live, and she had eaten garlic, like at a previous meal, and she had been in the hospital, you know, for days and days, and there was no reaction from the father all this time. Anyway, she went to give her father a kiss. You know, he was totally out of it, and he woke up, and he said, that is the strongest smell of garlic, and he actually lived another 6 months. But apparently, some people are really sensitive to the smell of garlic, and apparently Rebbe was the same case, and Rebbe says, I can't teach with the smell of garlic in the room. So Rebbe Chia, however, Rebbe says, whoever has garlic, please leave the room. Rebbe Chia got up and left the room, even though he was not the one who had garlic, so as not to hurt the feelings of the one who did. Of course, this only works then, which happened next, is everyone got up to go out. They followed Rebbe Chia's lead, because if the person stayed there, he would know that it didn't solve the problem. Another case that I think is important perhaps to talk about just for a moment. How are we doing for time? Oh, we don't have much time at all. All right, so maybe I'll end with this story, and maybe we'll pick up a little bit more in the whole theme, because what I want to actually talk about is, here we see a number of instances of lying that seem permissible. And the question is, so if lying seems permissible in all these instances, so where's the limit, right? Why does the Torah then tell us all these other instances? So that question we'll have to talk about at the very beginning of next week, because I'm otherwise going to go way over. But I'll just end with this last Gemara that seems to offer a suggestion of when lying is permissible. I gave you a couple of the examples to eradicate evil, right? If the person is trying to steal money from you, you're allowed to lie in that instance. So there's a famous case of Rav Shimon ben Shetach. Rav Shimon ben Shetach, you know, was trying to uproot sorcery and witchcraft and evil in Israel. And one of the ideas he comes up with is to get a number of scholars in this pouring rain. He goes to see the witches in this pouring rain, and he tells the scholars, hide dry clothes in this sort of container. They get there, they take out the dry clothes, they put it on, and he says, look, we're all dry, despite the rain that is going on outside. Clearly, my magic is greater than your magic. I've won. And indeed, it is successful. So there you see deceit is used to sort of wean people off of witchcraft by using, right, witchcraft. The reason why I brought this story reminds me of a famous case by someone by the name of Jean-Eugène Robert Houdin. Has anyone ever heard the case of this individual? It's a very fascinating case. Napoleon had invaded North Africa and was relatively successful in putting down most of the revolts, except in Algeria. And Algeria, you know, was a Muslim country, but there was still a strong degree of paganism amongst a number of people who were led by these people called the Marabouts. The Marabouts were tribal leaders who had magical powers, and people followed them, and they revolted. They continued to revolt against Napoleon because they would sort of keep their followers, you know, under their thumb by insisting that they had these powerful magical powers and they were scared of doing it. So France came up with this idea of sending this individual, Jean-Eugène Robert Houdin, who was one of the most famous magicians of the time in France. He studied electricity. Some say he invented the telephone 50 years before it was invented by Alexander Graham Bell. And he invented a number of tricks based upon his sort of knowledge of science and the like. And so he goes to Algeria, he goes to the capital, Algiers, and everyone is invited. I want you to see that the power, the magical power of France is greater than the magical power of your marabouts. And what he does is he takes a small little box, you know, something like this, and he puts it down and he says, who's your strongest man? I want you to come and pick it up. He's showing that it's very light, it's very simple. He puts it down on the ground, and the strongest man in Algeria comes and tries to pick it up and can't pick it up. It's just impossible. And he tries again, and all of a sudden he like gets a shake, he screams out, and finally he falls down. And everyone's very impressed with this incredible magical power. The incredible magical power was, of course, nothing more than an incredibly powerful magnet. The night before, under the sand, he had put this magnet, and he put the small metal box on the magnet. When he lifted it, no problem. When anyone else came to lift it, he simply flipped a switch, and it was impossible to lift up. And he one time was able to also shoot an electronic magnetic shock, so that was when he cried out in pain. Everyone was very impressed, and they basically, in Algeria at least, they gave up the rebellion. There were still some other marabouts in the tribal provinces that hadn't yet given up, and so he then traveled around trying to find the most powerful marabout around. One of them found him, got into his lair. He says, tonight I'm going to kill you. And he says, okay. And there's a famous case where the tribes person takes out a gun. Napoleon III. Takes out a gun and says, I'm going to shoot you. And he says, that's fine, but first let me show you something. He does a magical trick on the gun. He says, mark the bullet. You know, put some type of marking to show. Give me the gun. He puts the bullet in the thing, gives it back to the guy. The guy shoots him. Some blood splatters. But he's still standing. He spits out the bullet out of his teeth. Falls on the ground. He picks it up, and it's the same bullet marked there. And of course, what he did is he put like a fake blood in his chest, and he put a fake bullet that simply exploded but didn't actually hit anything. And the bullet itself that had the marking, he never put in the gun, he just put it in his mouth originally. But everyone was very impressed, and they actually never went to war as a result, and there was no revolt. And so you see a case of using their own magic to defeat them, much like Shimon ben Shetach. And of course, who did this inspire?
Houdini.
Houdini, right? Houdini took his name. Houdini is a Jewish guy by the name of Eric Weiss, who took the name Houdini because of the famous case of Houdini. There's one last source that I want to do, just I have 1 minute, which is to answer the question of if there's so many exceptions, you know, does it sort of remove the whole concept of thou shalt not lie? So there's a couple ways of answering. One is you can do what the Sefer Chinuch did. Say, we're only talking about a court case. And in a court case, you don't have these exceptions. Right? All these exceptions I spoke about were outside the realm of the courts, and that makes sense now. We said there were problems with the Sefer Chinuch's position of, well, now it doesn't apply to everyone, only if you're a witness, but he probably felt that there's the other problem. Lying actually is permissible in our day-to-day lives in certain instances. So therefore, if you want to take this thou shall not bear false witness seriously, it has to be in the court case. The other example, which is also a cute example, and then the third answer I'll give to the beginning of next week of why, which is sort of a deeper philosophical point. But the third case I want to just share with you for a moment is something, is the story in the Gemara in Yevamos. So I went looking for this Gemara. I remember reading it a long time ago, and I went looking for it because someone just sent me a text of something that took place at the San Francisco airport. The San Francisco airport, Uber, you know, which is the taxi company, was just outlawed from waiting at the arrivals, you know, collecting people from the arrivals, whether it's the taxi, you know, monopoly wanted to kick them out, whatever the case may be. So what Uber started to do, therefore, is waiting for people in the departures area of the thing, and you get your phone. It says, I'm upstairs, come to departures, don't go to arrivals. Everyone seems to be happy, except what happened? There's now so many cars at the arrivals, people dropping off, plus all the Uber cars doing pickup, so there's not enough room for there. So what people have started doing is when they're dropping people off at the airport, they drop them off at arrivals, because now arrivals is empty. So basically, people who are departing go to the arrivals, and people who are arriving go to departures. The exact opposite, right? In order to keep everyone happy. So this reminded me of this Gemara. So the Gemara says, Rav was constantly tormented by his wife. Apparently he had a challenging relationship with his wife. He would ask her to prepare him some lentils, and she would make peas. And then he'd say, I'd like to have some peas, and she would always make lentils. She always give him a little dig. So, however, Rav Chia, Rav's son, grew up, and eventually he was the one who would take the order from his father. And what he did, because he knew that his mother liked to sort of give it to Rav, would change the order. So his father would say, I want peas. He'd tell his mother, he wants lentils. She would then switch it to peas, which is exactly what he wanted in the first place. So one day Rav and his son Chia are having a conversation and says, you know, your mother is getting much better. You know, she used to always give it to me, but now she always gets the right order, you know, exactly as I want. So it's basically this arrivals and departures thing going on. Anyway, so he says, Chia says to Rav, he says, I have to be honest with you, I've been switching your orders because that way I know you'll get exactly what you want. So Rav was, of course, impressed by his son's ingenuity, but he says, you know what, don't do it anymore. Because even though what you're doing is accomplishing something positive, you should not get accustomed to lying. There's a problem, even when it's positive. And all these cases are positive, but the answer really is they're one-off instances. They're not a way of life. It's in the case you don't want to offend the woman who burnt the beans, that's fine. But you can't make it a common. And so what Rav is really arguing is people have to be careful that even in the instances of when you're permitted to lie, it's they're exceptional cases, not something you make a habit. If you make it a habit, it becomes a real, real problem. And in fact, under undercuts, undermines the whole concept of Midvar Sheker Tirchak. So those are two ways of responding to this question of what's the exception. Next week we'll begin with one more answer to that question, sort of more philosophical question, as well as then move to the last mitzvah, the Ten Commandments, of not to covet. Lo tachmod.